This double nature of the presentation this week, the part of the methods course and part of the data analysis course. So for those students in the methods course that are not going to continue further, this is really the main lesson, and for the rest that would be describing the tools. So we are going to do today filtering in the time domain. Okay, so I'll explain to you how to do things, but filtering by nature is related to notions of rate of fluctuations and frequency domain representations. So what I'm going to do is to use, without explaining, Fourier transforms, without explaining how I am doing them, but with explaining what you see. So hopefully this will also help you to get some feeling for the relationships between time domain and frequency domain representation of the same things. You'll see later. So we learned yesterday how to do low-pass filtering. Okay, low-pass filtering meaning taking a signal, removing high frequency, high fluctuation rates. Okay, so this is what we saw yesterday. The basic operation is taking some points, three in this case, and replacing, in this case, the middle one by the average of the three. And what I sort of insisted on describing it, instead of saying I'm taking the average of the three, I said I multiply this one by one third, that one by one third, that one by one third, and I add them. Okay? So the basic operation here is taking points, weighing them, multiplying them by numbers, and adding the result. Okay? The numbers by which I'm going to multiply each one of the points within my window of interest are going to remain fixed. So for the next point, I'm taking these three points, weighing them, in this case by one third each, okay, and summing, and so on and so forth. Okay. And as someone remarked yesterday, this is very similar to, almost identical to an operation that we call convolution. So those who know what a convolution is, okay, and those who don't, it doesn't really matter. Now, one problem that has to do with the practice of filtering is the fact that this operation is non-causal. It's non-causal in the sense that in order to calculate the value of that point, I'm using the value of that point as well. This is a future point. Okay, we have the tendency of thinking about this as a time signal, so the points come in sequentially as time goes by. And so in principle, if you would have accumulated that sequence in real time, at the time that you reach that point, you don't know what the value of that one is going to be. Now, in the filtering literature and the way that filter is implemented in MATLAB, there's a lot of emphasis on causal filtering. It's really unimportant for us because usually we filter much after the signal has been actually happening. Okay, we sample it on the computer and later we take it. So we have all the signal from the beginning to the end of the experiment. However, the MATLAB implementation of filter is causal, which means that in order to calculate that point, it allows to use only points from the past and the current points, but not future points. And that's true for implementation of filters throughout. So for completely wrong reasons, okay, we need to take into account this issue of causality. It's unimportant for us, okay, and eventually later in the lecture, I will show you, it causes damage and we need to get rid of it. Okay, but this is the way that MATLAB implements it and any other program that implement filters. That's how it does it, so we need to take this into account and then do something in order to avoid it, yes. Yeah, so MATLAB, I mean, the non-causal filtering in MATLAB, there is a function in MATLAB that does it. This is FillFilt that I was using yesterday. Okay, but I'll explain later how FillFilt works. It's based on filter. Okay, and I'll explain how to use FillFilt in order to get non-causal filtering. Okay, that's, but for the implementation and for the design of the filters, the assumption in MATLAB is that the filters are causal. So how does it look? Okay, for causal time domain filtering, you select a short window. Okay, so again, weights, one third, one third, one third, or whatever. Okay, 1,000 and one numbers, each one of which is 1/1,000, or a triangular shape, or whatever. I mean, the number that you are going to use. Okay, you take the piece of signal. Yeah, you weigh and sum, and now you replace the last point of that piece of signal by the new point. Okay, that's the difference. Not the middle point of the segment, but the last point of the segment. Okay, so this is how filtering works in MATLAB. Just a moment. Okay, so here's the signal. Here's the signal. I used it with a function randn. So randn generates pseudo random numbers that have Gaussian distribution, standard Gaussian distribution. Okay, so these are numbers with Gaussian, in principle, if I will take a lot of them, you will get a distribution that looks like the Gaussian, the normal distribution with mean zero and standard deviation of one. Okay, if I will run it again, it will generate a different segment, of course. Okay, here's another one. Okay, now I'm going to use the three-point averaging filter. Okay, so I'm already called it IMP stands not for a small daemon, but for impulse. Okay, that's this is called the impulse response. You will see later. I will not prove, but I will illustrate why it's called the impulse response. And as I said, the process now is to take three points from the old signal, for the first three points of the signal, multiply them by the weights in imp and sum, and then replace the last point, the third point in the new signal in the output by that number. Okay, so this will look like that. Okay, same convention as before. I take these three points, okay, I weigh each one of them by one third, sum and replace the last point by the new value. Okay, so this is exactly what we did before. Okay, now I'm doing it to the next point. Okay, so I take points, weigh them by one third and replace the last one by this, and so on and so forth. Okay, so this is just a loop. Okay, so every time you can see how the three points that I'm using shift around. Okay, and the new points get generated. And I get the green line. Is it a smooth version of the original? Do you see it shifted? Yeah. It is shifted. In this case, it shifted by 1 point because of the way that I did it. And that's part of the problem because of filtering. Okay, because of filtering shifts peak. Now, I want to do, with filters, I can do all kinds of things. We learned today how to do low pass, high pass, and band pass filtering. But you can do all kinds of other things as well if you really want. Okay, the weights that I'm using in the window, this one third, one third, one third. Okay, I can choose them the way that I want, and they would determine what the filter does. Okay, so in general, low pass filtering will look like averages, okay, so you will get a filter that does low pass filtering will mostly be, will have positive weights that generate a kind of weighted average. Okay, high pass filters will have things that are highly fluctuating, and you'll see. And as I said, the time window, I mean, these weights that I'm using are called the impulse response. So let's see why they are called the impulse response. So here's a long piece of code. Okay, I'm doing here the I'm doing very explicitly the filter operation. First, I generate a signal. Okay, so again, these are things that you should get into the facility of doing. I'm generating a segment of 100 samples of a signal. So I zero it, I add an impulse. Okay, something, I put one at some point, so this gives me a large sudden jump somewhere. And then I add noise. Okay, the noise is a little bit of normal Gaussian noise. So these lines generate my signal. Okay, next I'm going to generate the impulse response. So this is going to be an impulse response, an averaging, simple average of 9 points. Okay, so win is going to be a vector of length 9, each entry of which is 1/9. Okay, that's what these two lines are doing. And then I'm doing the filtering here. Okay. The 9 points that I'm considering now are going to go into this temporary vector called bus. Its length is 9. And at each point in time, I forget the oldest one, push the newest one, and here I'm doing the weighing and summing. Okay, and that's the new signal. Yes. No, I will show you the function filter. This is really, that's what the function filter does inside. Okay? So you will never have to write that segment of code. Okay? The first one you might want to do from time to time because you may want to check what your filter does on data that you understand. Okay. Also, if you want to generate music or things like that, okay. So we'll do this type of signal generation quite a lot later. I mean, in the last 2 weeks of the, certainly in the second week of the course, we are going to generate a lot of signals. Okay, but it's fun and it's useful very often. If you want to run simulations and things like that, that's the okay. Okay, so now I'm doing the filtering. I'm running the whole thing, and here's the result. Okay, so blue is the original signal. Noise, impulse. Okay, red is the filter signal. What can you say about it? Is it a good, smooth version of the blue line? No. Why? First of all, it's not that bad, okay? Here it's smoothed quite nicely. Okay? But we did something terrible to the pulse. Okay? What did we do to the pulse? Widened it and reduced it much in size and shifted it. Okay, so now pulses, these type of short things are worst things to filter. Okay, in fact, they are impossible to filter without damaging them. But I'm using it as an example here because I have a point to make. Okay, what is this? That's my window. Okay, this is up to noise. That's this flat top of the 1/9. Okay, what's the value of what's 1/9 as a number? Okay, so up to noise, that's the number that appears there. Okay, so the impulse, because there was an impulse here, I got my window out. Plus, okay, just to show you that this is indeed so, I'm going to do now the same exercise, exactly the same text, except that I'm going to use a different window. So now my window is going to be a triangle. Okay, triangle is a MATLAB function that gives you back a triangle. Okay, so 9 points, so the peak is going to be at point number 5, and it goes up 4 points, goes down 4 points. Okay, again, I normalized the window to have a total sum of 1, so this filter is also an averaging filter, but it's an averaging filter that uses weighted averages. Okay, it takes the middle point and give it the highest weight and gives smaller weights to points that are away from it. There are good reasons to do this type of weighted averages. We'll see them in the next set of lectures. Except for that, the text is exactly the same. And now, I'm going okay, so again, pulse in, triangle out. Okay, what about the rest of the signal? Pretty much the
same, maybe a bit less filtered. The triangle filters a bit less than the square.
Can you repeat what the triangle does exactly?
So I filtered exactly the same text, except that my impulse response now is triangle. So instead of taking 9 points and weighing them by 1/9 each, they take 9 points and weigh them by the number that comes out of the triangle. Okay, so the fifth point is weighed the most and the rest goes down. Okay, and now I shift this signal. Okay, the impulse goes into the filter and the triangle comes out. Okay, now if you do the math, you will see that if you think a little bit about this operation of putting the window, shifting it, and so on and so forth, you will see that this must be so. Okay, if you have an impulse, you get out the impulse response.
Okay, here's just a moment. I just want to do. Here's another example. Okay, instead of using a number that positive numbers that sum to 1, okay, which would give you a weighted average kind of
highly fluctuating weights. Okay, and exactly the same text.
So I told you if the weights are highly fluctuating, I'm going to have a high pass filter.
So you can see that the purple in a way is fluctuating more than the blue. So here for example the blue was a little bit smooth, but the purple was up and down. Okay, so it's high pass filter, okay, it's more fluctuating even than the random noise. But again, pulse comes in and you get the waves. Positive, negative, positive, negative, positive, negative, positive, negative, positive.
And here's the last example. Okay, so here I put weights that are completely arbitrary. Not completely arbitrary, okay?
I can't avoid doing things that are symmetric, but so they are symmetric around the middle, but they don't make sense. Okay, that's not something that
does anything useful. And again, does something to the blue, and when the impulse comes in, you get the waves out, this kind of funny shape. And just to show you that this is indeed the funny shape, I'm plotting the window on top. Okay, green.
The green line, okay, the green line is simply the window. Okay, and it overlaps pretty well, again, up to the fact that there was noise. The noise, it overlaps in all the signal. Okay, so this is why the window is called an impulse response. Okay, you put an impulse into the filter, you get out the impulse response. Okay, the response of the filter to the impulse.
And is this the
sample
equivalent of the transfer function? Or
transfer function is the Fourier transform of the impulse response. Okay, that's Alex, the transfer function?
Okay,
so I reduced the problem of designing a filter to the simple operation of actually finding an appropriate impulse response. Okay, that's what you have to do. If you want to design a filter, you want to find the impulse response. Now, actually, all the filters we've been discussing and all the filters that we will be using, that maybe is the last minute of the lesson today, are a subset of all possible filters that are called finite impulse response filters. Okay, they are finite impulse response because I select the duration of the impulse response, okay, and then just select the values within the duration. Okay, there's another family of filters in wide use that unsurprisingly are called infinite impulse response filters, IIR. It's not all the rest of the filter. Okay? It's a subset. It's also a subset of all possible filters. Sometimes there's a reason to use them. Again, for real-time applications, for when calculations or computation time is important and things like that, the IIR filters are very important. For our purposes, for the type of applications that most of us will be using, FIR filters are good enough. Computers don't feel much the amount of computation that we impose on them, even if we use quite long impulse responses. So I strongly advocate using finite impulse response filters unless you really have to and know what you're doing. They are simpler to understand, simpler to analyze, they have better properties in many respects, and so you and they can
can implement essentially everything you want, approximate everything you really need. Okay, so what do we need to learn in order to apply to design an applied filter? Okay, first of all, we have only a rough idea about the relationship between the input response and what the filter is actually doing, so that's something that I will have to explain to you. When we design a filter, we know what we want it to do, okay, and then we need to find the input response. So I will describe in some details of the MATLAB function that does that. Okay, at least for low pass, high pass, and band pass filters, it does exactly that, to give you the total frequency and provide you with the input response. With a input response, we can do it. And as a rule, it's good enough. We have this issue of causality, and we have the issue of edge effects. I didn't emphasize it, but that's something that we have to at least to know that it happens. Filters are conceptually transformations from the set of infinite sequences to the set of infinite sequences. However, in the computer implementation, you provide it with a segment, okay, that starts somewhere and ends somewhere, a finite number of samples. So the implementation of filter must assume something about what happens before and after the segment provided it, and almost invariably, implementation of filters assumes that signal is zero before and after. For instance, an assumption, but sometimes it causes trouble, and the edge effect very often has to do with this assumption. I will see it. Okay, so let's start by designing a low pass filter. Okay, so how do I design a low pass filter? Yesterday, how did we do it? We looked at the data, we saw fluctuations that we said are irrelevant because there are machine noise and things like that. Okay, and then we want to get rid of these past fluctuations. Okay, so let's I'm going to we are going to do it again. Okay, same file that we used yesterday. Okay, this is the Purkinje cell, recording from the Purkinje cell that we used yesterday. Okay, so I want to look for signals that are too fast to be biological. Of course, there are two. They're in the computer side, okay, so there are two, but they're not, their source is not, what I mean here is that their source is most probably not biological. Okay, so this is just one bit of the signal at some point. Okay, I selected that point again. I went over the signal by hand, I selected a bit of it, and here I plotted that bit. The x-axis is in milliseconds. Okay, and this, as far as I remember, this is a bit of an upstate. I don't remember now, maybe downstate, but it doesn't matter. Okay, what I want to the point is that we have here this type of very, very fast fluctuations. Okay, one point goes down and the next one goes up. One point goes up and the next one goes down. This type of fast, big fluctuations, as we said yesterday, would usually not be of a biological source. And the reason, as I said, is that if this was done, if the data acquisition system that sits between the record and the computer works correctly, it would contain a low pass filter, an analog low pass filter that would make sure that everything below 10 kilohertz, about 10 kilohertz is completely covered. Why 10 kilohertz? Half the sampling frequency, okay? Remember, this is 20 kilohertz, sampling frequency.
Now, filters can't cut off exactly at a frequency. They usually start to cut below it, and you need that at 10 kilohertz, there would be already a substantial amount of attenuation, so the filter would actually start cutting at a lower frequency than 10 kilohertz, at 8 or 7 kilohertz. Now, thing that goes tap, 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 is at 10 kilohertz. Okay? Thing that changes direction in every sample, okay? That's the signature of something that goes at something like 10 kilohertz. Analogically, this thing has been removed from the signal before it goes to the sampler. So if it exists in the numbers, as we see them here, it's a sampling process that reintroduced them into the signal. And that's why I'm pretty sure when I see things like that, that they are not biological. Okay, so I want to filter things certainly a little bit below 10 kilohertz. Okay, but actually when you look at it, okay, it looks like there's nothing much that happens over a time period of one millisecond. Okay, the thing goes up and down and up and down and up and down. So what I'm going to do is to design a filter that cuts at 1 kilohertz. Okay. And why 1 kilohertz? Because I'm saying that between over 1 millisecond worth of data, nothing happens. 1 millisecond is the period of 1 kilohertz. So the function that I'm going to use is called CO1. Yes.
There must be
a low-pass filter, an analog low-pass filter between the electrode and the sampler. Okay, but the sampler has frequencies that are presumably above the cutoff point of the low-pass of the analog low-pass filter.
Yes.
But if it has such frequencies, they must come from after the analog filter and before the computer file.
So where do you use the analog filter?
So, as a rule, most modern data acquisition systems, so the Alpha Omega data acquisition system, Axon, all the integrated intercellular amplifiers, the samplers, have a low pass filter that changes itself together with the sampling rate platform. Okay, so they give you an integrated thing. So if you say that you want to sample at 20 kHz, you attach the electrode on one side and get the computer file on the other side. So nowhere you can put your local filter by yourself, or they put it for you. Okay, and they design it so it would be okay. If you read the specification, you will find the specification of that low pass filter. It's an analog low pass filter. If it's very important for you, it will tell you what the so-called loop is, like how much chip speaks. It's a real-time filter. It must be closer, so it will shift a little bit the signal. Usually not by much. Okay, so if the cutoff point is at about order of 10 kHz, it can shift the peaks by a couple of hundreds of microseconds. If it's important for you, sometimes it is important, so you want to know that you can find it in the specification of the amplifier.
values, you make sure that there's an so-called anti-aging filter for something like that. I want to reiterate a little bit or some explanation about this issue of filtering for sampling is in this chapter that you have on the Doodle page, on the Moodle page, okay, and you should read it. And tomorrow we will talk a little bit about it. Okay, so 0-1 is the most basic function for FIR filters. Okay, and there are many, it has many options, like a lot of MATLAB music in sophisticated ways, but that's the simplest way of doing it. Okay, you provide two numbers. The first number is essentially the length of the impulse response, and the second is the corner frequency. Okay. What is exactly the corner frequency between the modes? So, n is almost the length of the impulse response because phi 1 returns an impulse response that's one longer than n, it's like n plus 1. Okay. Why? That's because of all kind of old baggage that MATLAB carried, okay, but you need to get used to it. Okay, the rule of thumb is that you want the filter to be longer than the longest period of interest. Okay. For a high-pass filter, for a low-pass filter, the frequency of interest is the corner frequency. And for a band-pass filter, the longest period is the period of the low side of the filter, the amount of the high side. Okay, so the filter has to be longer than the period of the lowest frequency of interest, or the longest period of interest, and three times the period of the corner frequency is fine. That's easy enough. You can manage also with shorter numbers, you do the bit of the quality on the filter. Okay, I'm not going to discuss that. You want an odd length impulse response. Okay, for certainly for low-pass filter, you want an odd length impulse response because it's the kind of weighted effort so you want to have the result to correspond to real samples in your data. Okay, so you want the impulse response to have length as an odd number, so you specify an even number. You get n plus one. And then, so that's one number that you need to provide, and the second one is the corner frequency in funny units. Okay, so you provide the corner frequency in units such that one is half the sampling frequency. So two is the full sampling frequency. And again, there's a reason for that, but I did not. That's one of these decisions that engineers and programmers are doing is that eventually users can't understand where it came from. Okay, but these are the units that MATLAB started with, and that's the unit that you have to continue using. Okay, so you give 0-1 these two numbers, and it gives you back the impulse response, okay, the weights that you are going to use for the filtering. So here is how it works. So, field one, I want my corner frequency to be 1000 Hz at 20 kilohertz, which is my sampling rate. The period of 1000 Hz is 20 samples. Okay, that's why I have here 20 times 3. Okay, that's 3 times the period of the frequency of input. And here I have 1000 Hz in units in which half the sampling rate is 1. Okay, so I divide by the something rate and multiply by 2. Okay, that's, I find it, I could also write it like that.
Just doing it the way that I did. Okay, that's exactly the same. Okay, so
I usually write it this way. So I got the impulse response, and this is how it looks like.
Okay, these are the weights. Again, it's an odd filter. Since I asked for a filter of length n is 60, the length is 61. Okay, so the middle point is at 31.
Filter is symmetric. Here one will, for most basic usages, here one will return symmetric filters. And you can see that most of what it does is use positive weight. It has a little bit of negative weight here and here. Okay, and the reason they are there is in order to make the transition from, they have to make the transition from the so-called pass band, the frequency that we pass to the stop band, the frequency that we want to reject, it helps making that transition faster. There's mathematical reasons for the fact that we have these negative loads, but that's
beyond the scope of today. Okay,
so now I'm going to make my first transition to the frequency domain, and then we'll go, we'll have the break. Okay, this is what I asked Sphere 1 to give me, and it provided an impulse response, but now I want really to know which frequencies this filter is going to pass and which frequencies it's going to reject. So I'm going to use a function called FrecV. Okay, FrecV plots the impulse response. I take the input response and provide the frequency domain characterization. Now, it provides a very complicated frequency domain characterization of which we need only one bit, which is the attenuation values as a function of frequency. The arguments are the input response. Okay, a second argument is always one for FIR filters. It's there for IIR filters if you want to use them. For FIR filters, it's always 1. And then we need a number that's the resolution of the frequency representation, and this is the good default. Okay. You may need less than that, you will rarely need more than that. So, and again, the amount of calculations here is not really an issue, so this is a good number. And then you provide it with your sampling frequency so that it will know which number to put on the frequency axis. Yes? Yeah, I mean, you can calculate that, and you are going to get attenuation as a function of frequency. Okay, but again, that's only a finite number. I mean, that's a finite sampled version. So the question is, at how many different frequencies you are going to get the values? Okay, and as a rule, the features in frequency are relatively close, so this is a very high resolution in frequency. You don't need more than that. As I said, you can use a lower resolution than that, but this you would want to use a smaller resolution only for numerical reasons, and the computers today are so powerful that this is essentially a zero time operation.
But it's not a function of the
impulse response? No. Because usually your impulse response will be substantially shorter. It should be longer than the impulse response, but your impulse response usually will be substantially shorter.
In time. So the relay frequency is not at play.
What?
The relay frequency is not at play.
Well, I take back a little bit because you are working with very slow potentials. So you might have all kinds of high pass filters at 1/10 of Hertz or things like that. These might have impulse responses that are very long if you're something like that. should be longer than that. So signals of the type that electrophysiology is used and non-human electrophysiology is usually used.
Well, I'm actually speaking about the frequency, but if I understand, Ender is basically how brainy.
Yeah, so this is what I'm saying. This should be longer than the impulse response, but usually, as a rule, the impulse responses are much shorter than that. Okay, so that's not the limitation.
Okay, so here is flex Z. Yes.
This is not causal process.
It is. We will operate it and we'll,
and after the break, I'll use it to filter and we'll see how causal it is and how annoying it is. It will cause a shift in the peaks of half the period of the
filter, which is 1.5 milliseconds here. Okay, that's a lot. Okay, so but here is the frequency. So as I told you, it's more complicated than you really need. Okay, so first of all, you know what? It's already 4 to 10. So we'll start by I'll start by explaining this after the break. יש כאן המינג ווינדו שגורם לכך שה...
הלוגס הראשונים פה ופה הם עובד יותר גבוהים, מה שאתה רואה אותם פה כן? מה שזה הופע לחלון המינג זה לא המינג, עושים את כמו יש לו לא
גבוה אז יהיה משמעות הפיקים, יהיה משמעות חזקה לפיקים הבאים בעצם כהמינג יהיה קצת יותר לבד
אם אתה תראה, אם אתה תיקח לא לרוק יותר
שוב,
אחד בעצם האור של אינטרנט.
לא, השאלה באיזה יחידות היא כבר, כאילו היא קצוע שקטה ביחס למה ביחס לאן?
שאלה מה אין?
במקרה הזה אין זה 8192, נכון שזה יהיה עם הסירופטים.
לא, שאלה בדיזיין של הפילטר.
אז אין זה משהו שווה באומגה, נכון? זה דאגי הוא אומגה.
אין,
אבל
זה
תלוי
ב...
זה הקאטו פרקות שלו.
התנאי של ה-T3 מטרתו בדיוק לבחור שהסיידו בראשון יהיה בתוך החלום. זה נכון גם לגבי מטרה אחת של ה-T3.
Thank you.
sophisticated way of thinking about it. Okay, so here's the impulse response. And here's the call to flex Z. So first argument is the impulse response, the second is 1 because we are using FIR filters. It will always be 1. This number, this frequency resolution brought up a lot of questions. I'll show in a moment what it is, but as a rule, as long as this is much longer than the duration of B, you can just plug in that number and that's it. Okay, forget about what it means. Okay, if it will be important, if it will become important, you will really, you will be probably knowledgeable enough to vary it the right way. And this is a sampling rate. Okay, again, this doesn't change anything about the calculation of the numbers, but it is there in order to, for the program to know what, how to label the x-axis. Okay, and then, okay, so we'll consider right now only the top one. Okay, I will talk a little bit about the bottom curve in 2 weeks. Okay, so on the x-axis we have frequencies. They go from 0 to half the sampling frequency. And each number here is the attenuation that the filter will provide if you put through it a sine wave at that frequency. Okay, so, and now the y scale is a bit, is in funny units, okay? It's in dB units. So, yeah, and where this number, the place where this number is expressed is in the density of points here. Okay, so this number tells me that there are actually half that number, okay, half of 8192, so 4096, different frequency values at which the attenuation has been calculated. Okay, this is the meaning of that number. Okay. So I want to speak a little bit about the y-axis. Did you ever encounter, or who never encountered the dB units in his life? Okay, so okay, exercise. 0 dB magnitude here. How much attenuation does the filter provide? 1.
Something. Okay, so
20, it's 6.0 something. Okay, so it's a number worth remembering. Okay, minus 6 dB is a factor of, factor of 2. 6 dB is a factor of 2 in amplitude form. Okay, and then the standard thing. So an attenuation of 1/10, okay, 0.1, will give you minus 20 dB, 100 will give you 140 dB, will give you minus 40 dB, and so on. Okay, so 60 dB is an attenuation of 1,000. Again, these are the kind of, this is the kind of things you should remember. It helps you doing back of envelope calculation and all of kind of things like that. Okay, now the important point, corner frequency. Okay, this frequency that I provided to Sphere 1, okay, Sphere 1 uses it to the filter is designed so that the attenuation of that frequency is minus 6 dB. That a corner frequency is defined as that frequency at which attenuation is 1/2. Okay, so minus 6 dB.
Yeah, just to prove it to you. Okay, the
ultimate attenuation of the filter you can see here would be about slightly, I mean, around one, around minus 60 dB. So it would attenuate frequencies in its typically it would attenuate frequencies in its passband a bit more than minus 60 dB. So to 1,000 the values, the original values.
Yes. The current frequency where we expect to not set the presence of the frequencies after it. So minus 60 dB means that it's a very small attenuation. Something I defined as the cutoff frequency.
Say that again?
You said that I defined the cutoff for the corner frequency is 1,000 and that there you got a minus 6 attenuation. Isn't it a very small attenuation?
Yeah. That's why, this is why you need to be aware of it. Okay, when you design a filter, so one thing that you can see here is that transition from no attenuation, zero, to full attenuation, less than minus 60 dB, let's say, takes a range of frequencies. It doesn't happen at once. And that's, this is a, you, that's a trade-off that you always make when you design a filter. Okay, so when you design a filter, the, if you want to make this position faster, you need a longer input response. So, as a rule, when you think about the, what happens in frequency, you have to think not about two regions, passband and stopband, but about three regions. Okay, passband, stopband, and position band. Okay, so we have the passband, which by definition ends at the corner frequency. Okay, that's the definition of the corner frequency. Okay, and you have the stop band where the, you get the full attenuation. Okay, and then you have this length. When you design a filter, one of the design parameters is the width of the transition band. Okay, how much, how far in frequency are you from the corner frequency to the place where you get the full attenuation? Now, when I design an anti-aliasing filter, for example, it's an analog filter, not a digital filter, but the idea is all the same. And I have to make sure that at half a sampling frequency, I will be already in the stop band. And that's why the corner frequency will always be below that. So if my sampling frequency is 20 kHz, my corner frequency will not be at 10 kHz, it will be at 8 kHz. So I have the transition band and the full attenuation will happen already in half a sampling. To get a
brick wall kind of filter, you need an infinite length impulse response. Okay, so that's mathematics. Yes.
Can we also analyze like our triangular filters or the window filters and not just filters which are created by the PO1 option?
That's a very good exercise that you can do by yourself. Okay, you know how to do it, you know how to generate the B, okay, either square thing or what you will find out is that actually okay, I will not tell you what you will find out. Okay, but there are some aspects, in some respects this filter is better than the square filter, than the simple moving average kind of box cut filter, and in some respects it's worse, and the aspects for which it is worse are usually things that are less important than aspects for which this one is better, okay, that's why it's a bad one. Okay, there are always trade-offs. There are always trade-offs. Yes, ma'am.
The number used for the resolution here, around 8,000, is that just to use it without
I don't want to repeat, I don't want to discuss it again, we wasted enough time on it. Okay, so just remember, it should be longer than impulse response, and as a rule, it minimum would be longer than that, and if you want more explanation, come to me at the break. Okay, I don't want to waste time about it now, okay? Really. We already discussed it for too long. Just number, okay? Should be longer than impulse response. Okay? Okay, so we designed the filter, we talked a lot about it, so let's filter. So the function that does the actual filter operation is called filter. Okay, again, three arguments. The impulse response, one, as long as we are using finite impulse response filters, okay, the one is for the higher upright filters, and then the vector wants to filter. Okay, now I plot the blue is the filter is the blue is the original data and this type of ugly red is the filtered data. So first of all, start to see the time shifts. Okay, so you can see here the time shifts. Okay, you can see the blue line has a flat top here, but the red line has a flat top here. Okay, so that's the window, I guess.
Why the filter doesn't shift it back automatically? I mean, you would like to do that.
Because that's what the MATLAB designer decided that
to do. So you do it manually for that?
What?
So you do it manually?
I'm sure you can. Okay, but actually you can already see here another problem. Can you tell me what immediately jumps up? Something happens to the spikes. Okay, so let's look at the spikes. Again, it's 30 something points, 31 something points, that's 1.5 milliseconds, which in so that's an important shift. But the two other things that happened, one of them is that the spikes got smaller, they got distorted in shape, okay? The filter invented a triphasic instead of biphasic spike. Okay, there was a negative phase here. And it also widened it a bit. It's harder to see, magnified and
even more than you would see it better. And you can see that this is slightly wider than that. Okay, so why did that happen?
Remember, corner frequency 1000 Hz. Okay? This is time in milliseconds. Now tell me why the spikes got hit by the filter. What's the width of the spike? What's the width of the spike? How much?
1000 milliseconds.
Even shorter than a millisecond. It's about 1000 milliseconds. Okay, so since the spike is 0.5 milliseconds, by necessity, okay, it contains frequencies that are about 1000 Hz. Okay, that's this type of. You can see it in many different ways. The usual way of expressing it is by saying that this is an expression of this uncertainty type principle. If you have something that's very well timed in time, it will by necessity contain a lot of frequencies. Because in order to construct something that's narrow, you need at least to use frequencies as narrow as that thing. And it's a period as narrow as that thing. Okay, so this is less than 1 millisecond, so in order to construct it from sine waves, you by necessity needs frequencies that are about 1 kHz. Okay, now, that's what I did before in the eyeballing, okay, was a mistake on purpose. Okay? When you eyeball the signal in order to design the corner frequency of your low-pass filter, okay, you have to consider the fastest event in your data. And as a rule, in this type of electrophysiological recordings, the fastest thing that you will hear are the spikes. Okay, so you need to look at the, in order to select the low-pass filter, you need to look at the spikes and make sure that your corner frequency is high enough so it will not damage or not damage much the spikes.
Okay, what did I want to say here? Yeah, we'll discuss that. Now, again, because spikes
spikes are broadband, okay? Because they are narrow in time, they will contain a lot of frequency. Okay, so a lot of frequencies mean also a lot of high frequencies. Okay, so if you remove frequency, you will hit spikes. And so, as I said, these type of fast events are the hardest thing to filter. In most cases, you will have, again, the sampling rate that we are using, in most cases, you will need to do some trade-off. A bigger spike, not much.
Okay, so I'm going to design a different filter.
1000 Hz was too low, so I'll use 6000 Hz instead.
So this is like this, so again, now the filter doesn't attenuate anything up to very high frequencies. At 6 kHz it has an attenuation of 6 dB. Okay, again we can see it. Okay, 6,000 Hz, it's minus 6 dB. Okay, because this is what I told him to do. And so now the spikes looks okay. Again, I check. Oof. You see the time shift, yes? You can see the time shift, but the shapes are fine. I mean, there's no... On the other hand, okay, the... Okay, so I try a third time. Okay, this time it's a filter with a common frequency of 3 kHz. It's sort of in the middle. Again, that's the impulse response. I don't need to draw it again, okay? It will look exactly the same except for the place of the common frequency. And so I already see that the spikes are seems to be at least at this coarse resolution they are well preserved. And at this resolution they are also well preserved. So the spikes are fine. And the smoothing is
did something. You can see how the red line is a bit smoother than the blue line. Okay, so 3 kHz simply by hand, okay, I got 3 kHz as a frequency that would filter, so it will smooth, remove noise, and so on the one hand, and on the other hand, preserve the events of interest, which are the part event of interest here with those spikes. This type, by the way, of trial and error, I'll give you some ways to get to guess better, okay, but eventually you need to do it. Okay, so let's deal now with the causality. So there are two ways. One that has been suggested in a moment, we can do non-causal filtering and then shift back the signal. Okay, that's we'll do that. Sometimes you want to do that. The other way is the problem with doing it is that in order to shift back the signal, you either lose point or you have to add fake point before the beginning. Okay, so you need to do something like that. MATLAB doesn't have a package procedure for doing it, so I have to do it by hand. What MATLAB gives you is a kind of a funny thing. Okay, it's
filter procedure that actually filters the signal twice. Once going forward, so everything is shifted in one direction, and then it operates as if time went in the reverse. So it filters it from the end to the beginning, and then everything shifts back. Okay, so after operating with the filter twice, once forward, once backward, the peaks get back in place. Okay, the problem is that the filter that you use is not the filter that you designed, okay? It's twice the filter that you designed. Okay, so it has a different attenuation value, a different frequency. For example, its corner frequency is going to be a bit lower than it's a locus filter. Its effective corner frequency will be a bit, it will be smooth more than when you really are. So a bit more. Sometimes it's important, sometimes it's not. Okay, so let's see how these options work. So I'm designing here a filter. Again, that's my signal, it has an impulse. Okay, this is for doing these examples. So I'm using this this impulse because it provides a definite point in time. Okay, it's a signal that's all zero except for this point number 13, which I put 1. Okay, and I'm going to use now I'm going to use filter, but I'm going to use filter on the longest on a signal. Okay, I want eventually to shift it back, so I need to lengthen it. Okay, to filter a longer signal so I can shift it back. Okay, so I lengthen it. Why did I put it that way? What's the do you know enough MATLAB to figure out what this is? Yeah, this is concatenating column vectors. Okay. If you put matrices next to each other, you concatenate in this direction. Okay, here I wanted to concatenate in that direction. Okay, so I need to use this type of syntax. Okay, so this is the original signal, and this is after the function of filter. Okay, I got back my impulse response, which is a kind of, it's called the Hamming window, it's a kind of raised cosine. Okay, and it has all the drawbacks of the causal filtering, it's shifted. Obviously, it's reduced and widened because that's an impulse, I can't avoid it. That would happen anyway. Okay, and now, so I filtered it and then I shifted it back. Okay, so shifting back means simply taking this signal, okay, instead of starting at time 0, I start at time 5. Okay, this is why I lengthened it in this direction, okay, so that I can pull it back and have 100 data points. Okay, so this is the result. There are still problems, okay? What's the problem? What's the problem now with the impulse? The yellow one. So it's reducing size, it is widened, and what?
You have fake points.
I have fake points, but I always have fake points at the beginning and end and when I do filtering, but there's something else here that you need to know. Okay, it starts earlier. This would happen in any non-causal filtering. Okay? The impulse, now if you ask about what is the latency to the signal, okay? After filtering, the latency shortens. Okay? Now this is going to always happen when you do non-causal filtering, okay? And that's something you should know. If it's important to have a very high precision measure of latencies, know that filtering, any kind of filtering will be distorted. Potentially will be distorted. Any kind of non-positive filtering will be distorted. If you do this type of filtering, you want latencies to peaks, okay? Because you filter so that the peaks will stay in place. Okay? But if you want to have the offset, then you have to do something.
Yes.
This is just keep shifting back the filter version, okay? That's not the filter type. Okay? Okay, let's see how it how this works for the real signal. So that was just an example. Okay, so again, instead of filtering this figure, I filter this figure length length by zero. Okay, zero extended, so then I shift it back. Okay, and after the filter, I just take the relevant part. Okay, so I take the part that starts at half the filter length plus. Okay, so let's look at the spikes again. These are the important bits. Okay, so now it's beautiful. And also here you can follow well, you can understand what's the relationship between the blue and the orange red line. So you can see how it's moving. Because things are now in place. So that's a good procedure, but it's a bit complicated to manage in MATLAB. Okay, MATLAB provides this procedure of going back and forth. So here I implemented it again by hand. I filter in one direction, and then flip up down. You have also flip LR, which is flip left right. Okay, flip up down takes a column vector and invert it. Flip LI, okay, takes a row vector and invert it. Okay, here I have my vectors are column vectors, so I use flip up down. So I filter once. And then I take the filter version, invert it in time, filter twice, and invert it back. Okay, so that's the procedure. Okay, and
this is for the fake impulse. Okay, so the original signal after single filter, and that after the double filtering.
Okay, so you can see the effect of the double filter here. This is even lower and even wider. Okay, that's the effect of doing the filter twice.
Now,
as I said, MATLAB provides me with a function filtfilt that essentially encapsulates that. Okay, filtfilt, except for edge effects that it tricks, okay, the heart of filtfilt is this line. This line. Okay, so filtfilt does that. Okay, filters fig in one direction and then backwards with the same input response.
And I'm going to run this, but the figure here won't change, okay, because it's exactly the same. Okay, so I got the same, it redrew it, okay, but it's
exactly the same.
Okay, and again, we can look at what happens with real signals. So, let's look at a different segment. Okay, so there are three lines here.
This is the result of filter. Okay, and here you have the blue and the yellow are the original and peak fit. And again, you can see the fact that the peak fit doesn't shift the peaks, they occur at the same time.
And also, you can probably see that even here, the field smoothes a little bit more than filter.
This part is the same as in the red vest part, and it's a little bit smoother.
Okay, so all of that was about low pass filtering. I do with you now very fast high pass filtering, yes.
When you design the filter, you should take under advisement the fact that if you want to use this filter, you need to use it twice.
Yeah, so this goes to, the answer is yes, but, okay. you want the analysis to be robust to your filter. So the shift in the corner frequency is not very large. Okay, the attenuation at the nominal corner frequency, instead of being 1/2, is going to be 1/4, 1/2 squared. Okay, so it's going to be minus 12 dB, and the attenuation at the corner frequency is going to be whatever was the frequency at which attenuation was half of it, minus 3 dB. Okay, which is a little bit lower, not much lower. So the corner frequency of each field is going to be lower, but it's going to be lower by a little bit. Instead of 6 kilo, 3 kilohertz, it will be 2.9. Now, if this changes your significance from 0.049 to 0.055, and you put it in your paper, okay, that's... you are doing the best thing, okay? So, you need the analysis to be robust to this type of selection. That's partially why I advise you to use a number of different parameters to check that it doesn't matter. What you shouldn't do is test a number of different parameters and optimize. Okay. That's bad, because that's multiple comparison type of thing. Okay. What you should do is make sure that changing by a few hundred hertz the corner frequency using filters instead of field online, things like that, doesn't change the conclusion. Okay, it doesn't change your conclusion. So your analysis is robust relative to robust with respect to this type of decisions. Okay, let's do high pass filter. This is really repeating the same thing, except that now we want to get rid of low frequencies and not of high frequencies. So I'm going to go quite fast about it. Okay. At that point, when I generated the script, I got bored with the pinch cells, so I brought up a different set of data. These are data. These are recordings from RET auditory cortex. These are extracellular recordings. Okay, sampling frequency is 24.04 kHz. Okay, 24.04 Hz. Okay, so I'm going to plot one trial. Tomorrow you're going to work a bit with this data, so the x-axis is in seconds now. What you see is half a second worth of data. There was a tone here. The tone started is always starting at 50 milliseconds here. Okay, and this huge thing is actually a response to the tone. Okay. This is a so-called local field potential. Okay. It represents a lot of integrated currents from many, many, many different units.
auditory cortex has a huge amount of synchronous inputs. When you present a good tone to the region of the electrode, there's a huge convergence of extremely well timed, the millisecond range inputs, so you get these huge negativities, which are the local field potential. And the spikes ride on top of that. Okay, these are the etheric stuff is the spikes.
Okay, so let's look at the spikes.
Okay, these are the spikes. This is 1 neuron that fire tended to fire in burst. Okay, and I'm telling you, because it will become important in a moment, that the typical interval between spike and the next in this burst is about 2.5 milliseconds. Okay, what's the frequency that corresponds to 2.5 milliseconds? Hertz, 2.5 milliseconds in hertz. What's the frequency of period is 2.5 milliseconds? How do you calculate it?
400
hertz. Okay, so it's 1,000 divided by 2.5. Okay, so the rate, the firing rate in this burst is 400 hertz.
Okay, now sometimes I'm interested in the local field potentials, but very often I will be interested in the spikes.
Okay, and so this is the so-called broadband signal, that's all the electricity that came out of the electrode, but when I'm trying to detect the time of the spikes, I want to get rid of the low frequency, the local field potentials, and keep the spikes. Okay, so typically when I get a signal like this, one of the first things that I'm going to do is hyperspeed. So that's a typical use of the hyperspeed.
Okay, I put here the time in seconds, but actually it's more convenient to look at the time in milliseconds. Okay, so now you can see that the fact that the distance is slightly more than 2 milliseconds. From one spike to the next. Okay, you have one line every 2 milliseconds, so you can see that the distance between spikes is slightly more than the distance between the grid lines. What's the width of these spikes?
These things are about 300 microseconds wide, okay, so that would be typical to extracellular spikes. Why are they narrower than intercellularly recording spikes? A bit faster than the intercellular potential. Basically, okay, if you will look at the physics that underlies the solar current, this is the derivative of the spike shape. Okay, what you see, most of the currents, okay, the largest currents, extracellular currents, occur on the rising phase of the potential. Okay, so in order for the potential to increase very fast, you in the rising phase of the extra potential, you need large currents. Okay, so that point corresponds not to the peak of the extra potential, but to the highest slope of the extra potential. Okay, so this thing reflects more the rising phase of the extra potential than its width. That's a very rough explanation. But,
so wouldn't we see also a
Yeah, that's why they are bipolar. Extracellular spikes tend to be bipolar. Okay, extracellular spikes tend to look like that. Okay, so this is roughly the rising edge, and that's the falling edge of the action potential. Again, very roughly, because it's not exactly derivative. Okay, it's a bit more complicated than that. But there is a derivative component in it. Okay, make this shape. Okay, so what's the typical frequency for an action potential? For a local field potential, excuse me, I want to get rid of the local field potential. So my corner frequency now is going to be the highest frequency that's relevant to the local field potential. But I want to remove them. So what's the typical fluctuation rate here of the local field potential?
10 hertz.
Yeah, 10 hertz would be a bit slow. Okay, the 10 hertz is 100 milliseconds, so fluctuation of 100 milliseconds would look like this. Okay, but you can see that this thing, for example, is now under that. Okay, so 10 hertz probably too low. Okay, the width of this is less than 50 milliseconds, would be about 30 milliseconds. So that would correspond, 30 milliseconds would correspond to about 30 hertz, so at least 30 hertz. But actually, there are even faster stuff here. Okay, for example, this thing. Okay. This is also a local field potential. This whole thing is also a local field potential thing, and you can see that it's 10 milliseconds.
Right.
Okay, so the right order of magnitude would start at about 100 hertz in order to get rid of local field potential. Okay, so I design now a filter that would be a high pass filter. Okay, so how do I use field 1 to design a high pass filter? I provide it with the duration, with the length of the impulse response. Okay, so why 240 times 3? I want a corner frequency of 100 Hz. Okay, sampling frequency is about 24 kHz. 100 Hz is lost time, lost the period. 10 milliseconds. Okay, 10 milliseconds. And the duration of 10 milliseconds at 24 kHz is 240 milliseconds. So this is the period of the frequency of impulse times 3. Okay. And again, 100 Hz in units in which half the sampling rate is 1. That's the formula. Okay, and in order to make it the high pass filter, I provide the option high. And then tier 1 will generate the high pass filter. So we'll just look at it and then take the break. Yeah, actually, so first of all, you can see that it's a high pass filter. Okay, these are the attenuations. So it doesn't, it attenuates everything above 100, it passes everything above 100 Hz. Okay, so it attenuates low frequencies. Okay, at 100 Hz, the attenuation is going to be minus 6 dB. 100 Hz, okay, so you see that it's minus 6 dB. Okay, and it passes everything that's substantially above that. Okay, let me show you the impulse response. Okay, so the impulse response looks like that. You have a big impulse at zero. Okay, so this is really a single point that's very high, close to one. And the rest, okay, looks pretty much like the low pass filter that we had, except that it inverted. Okay, so what does it do? It takes the sample and subtracts from it the result of the low pass filter. Okay, so this impulse response, in fact, implements what we did yesterday. Okay, it first low pass filter and then subtracted from the original signal. This comes automatically from the map. Okay, this is how you do high pass filtering. Okay, so we'll run that. Okay, so that's the result of the filtering. Before filtering, after filtering, you can see that I removed the slow fluctuations. Okay, so we'll take now the break and continue to discuss this later.
Thank you.
Okay, shall we continue? Okay, so first of all, let's look. You can see it already that that's not so, this is actually pretty good. Okay, it did remove the slow fluctuations. It didn't remove all of them. So, for example, here you have something that's obviously not a spike. Okay, and it comes from here. You can see it in the blue too. Riding on top of the, okay, so it's this thing, okay, it goes like that. Okay, so, and it's obviously not spike. Okay, so we may want to remove it too, and in order to do that, the fact that it remained means that our corner frequency may be too low relative to what we want to do. So here's, here I filter it again with a corner frequency of 200 Hertz. Okay, again, I left the length the same. I could make it a bit shorter. Okay, but I left the length of the filter the same. It doesn't matter. Okay, so now to a large extent, I got rid of this thing. And the question is whether the spikes are okay. Okay, as I told you, spikes are hard to filter. They contain a lot of frequency, both high and low frequencies, so I need to make sure that the spikes will not hit. So what I want to do is to plot these spikes on top of these, okay, in order to show that they did not, that there's no damage. So I'm plotting this one trial from the data, and I shift the filtered data down by a number, okay, that I determined before, okay, would get the spikes to the same voltage level. Okay, so here they are. So it might look as this one is a bit smaller than that one, but that's not exactly true. You can see that they don't start at the same baseline. This spike, well, the peaks are exactly the same. The baseline is also exactly the same. Okay, the widths are essentially the same, so the spikes did not get hit by this filtering. Okay, the spikes are okay. So this 200 Hertz is a good filter. Okay, so that was a high pass filter. Yes. Because again, the typical frequency content of the spike would be centered around the width. The width is about is less than 1 millisecond, so the center of the frequency content would be above 1 kilohertz. Okay. In consequence, if I cut things below 200 Hertz, I don't touch much their frequency content. But you have to make sure. Okay. You do when, for example, when you filter intercellular spikes, okay, a filter like that would modify their shapes. Okay, so last trick, bandpass filters. Okay, so for bandpass filters, you need to specify two frequencies, okay, the so-called high pass frequency, which is the low frequency, and the low pass frequency, which is the high frequency. Okay, that's again not my definitions. This is how things are called in the literature. So, how do we do that? We simply provide a vector of two frequencies to FIR1. So, by default, if FIR1 sees two frequencies, you design a bandpass filter. You don't need to tell it explicitly that it should be a bandpass filter. Okay, so again, length of the impulse response, low frequency, high frequency, and these two frequencies have to be in units, so frequency is one. So I normalize them in this funny way. Okay, and If we look in the frequency domain, it looks like that. Okay, so it has the high pass, okay, at 200 Hz, and the low pass at 2 kHz, okay, and it suppresses things. Okay, so if I filter now the signal that way, okay, so what's good and what's not good? The spikes got smaller, 2 kHz is far too low. Okay, the low pass, okay, it's 2 kHz, is far too low for these spikes, okay, so they got smaller and wider. Okay, again, best way to see that they are wider is simply to increase the size here. So you can see that this red line starts to drop before and starts to rise later than the blue spike. Okay, so they became smaller and wider. This is what too severe low pass does. Okay, on the other hand, they smooth nicely this noise. Okay, this very fast noise. So the 2 kHz is good for the noise but bad for the spikes. And tomorrow, okay, one of your one of the goals of what of the exercise would be to maybe find a better high pass, a better band pass. Okay, I want to discuss a little bit edge effects. As a rule, you need not worry about, if you do it correctly, you need not worry about edge effects, okay? Do it correctly means filtering very long segments of signal, okay? So the edges are only very small bits of the signal. I have a slide at the end, but if you need to cut your signal to tiles, for example, filter first, cut later, okay? But sometimes you do need to filter relatively short segments of signal, and then the edge effects are important. Okay, so here's an example. So I took this trial data, whatever. Okay, the length is 24,000 points, and what I did here was simply to show the beginning. Okay, this is the beginning of the filtered data. Okay, so I use filter, okay, the causal version. Okay, so what happens is that the truly relevant data start here. Okay, that's the segment that corresponds to what happened here. Okay, but you have all of that long stuff and you have this jump. Okay, that happens here. So the most annoying thing about edge effects are when these jumps are introduced into the data. And the reason that this jump occurs is because the data here doesn't start at zero. You see, it starts above zero, but the filter assumed that everything before it was zero. Okay, so the assumption of the filter introduces an artifactual jump here. Okay, so just to make it emphasize it, I emphasize the jump. Okay, I move everything up, and I'm going to filter it again. So I instead of having the jump from here to here, I'm going to have the jump from here to here. Okay, and then if I filter it, I get an even larger bad thing here. Okay, jumps again. Like impulses, jumps tend to get out of the filter something that's not exactly the impulse response, but similar to the impulse response. Okay, so if you have a big jump, you get something that fluctuates. Okay, and that's what you see here. Okay, it jumps and then it does that. Okay, you see the type of fluctuation that it's called ringing. Actually, filt behaves a bit better in that respect. Okay, that's a result of filt, even after I moved everything up by 15,000. And the reason is that filt, instead of assuming that the signal starts with zero, okay, what it does is to take the signal and reflect it. Okay, so the trials, the samples that it invents that are not there, are these trials inverted in time. And so there are no jumps. It's still fake data at the beginning, okay? Because it still invents data that's not there, but the behavior is a bit better. Yes? Because, I mean, the reason that, okay, this example behaves that way because I applied a high-pass filter to the, I applied here a high-pass filter to the data. If I would have applied a low-pass filter to the data, then the artifact would look different, and you would need to do something else. Okay, so usually that's not a good idea. Anyway, that's faking. Okay, you don't want to fake. You want to have the real data. Your real data, the data that's valid, starts one impulse response duration after the beginning of the segment. Okay. Now, in fact, both filter and filt have options. You can call them with additional arguments that control the initial condition. This is very important. Okay, but you don't want to be there. Okay. The control of edge effects is important when the signals are short and the impulse responses are long. In fact, filter requires the signal you filter to be at least three times the duration of the impulse response. Okay, but you don't even want to be close to that limit. You want your invalid data to be so short that you can ignore it, okay, at the beginning of the signal. So the best way to solve edge effects is simply to filter a signal that's so long that the edges are unimportant. And you can ignore the edge effect. Now there are approaches for controlling edge effects that don't invent data. Okay, that use only the available data, but they use it differently close to the edges. Okay, that's for example the so-called Savitsky-Golay filtering. The MATLAB has it implemented. Again, if it's very important, if your segments are short and your input responses are long and you need to do something, then you can use it. But it's not that it's a better filter. It just uses the data in ways that doesn't fake anything. Okay, it uses only the available data. So you will still have things that happen close to the edge. I mean, the filters will be different close to the edge. So you don't want to use it unless you have to. Okay, unless there's no way but to filter a short segment. Okay, so where's my watch? What time is it? We have another half hour, so I want to talk a little bit about more principled ways of selecting the corner frequencies. By I is good, okay? At the end, this is what you want to do. But you would like to have the a way of converging to the right order of magnitude, maybe faster than going back and forth and back and forth. Okay, so you want somehow to have something that will summarize the fluctuation rate in your signal. Okay, and the thing that summarizes all the fluctuation rates in your signals are called power spectra. Now, in 2 weeks' time, okay, we are going to talk a lot about power spectra. Right now, I want to introduce them as a kind of a tool, okay, without a theory, okay. So, who never heard the term Fourier transform? Who never used the function FFT in MATLAB? Few of you. Okay, that's fine. It's unimportant. Okay, so what is the power spectrum? You have a lot of data. Data is random stuff. Okay? Your trials are random. Each one of them has a different shape and different different specifics. And what you want when you do, when you filter, is to have some sort of average. Okay? So what we do is take a signal. We use the function FFT. Provides the, again, without the details, okay, does is to give you the amplitudes, I mean the details of the sine waves that compose the signal, okay, in a format that we'll discuss in 2 weeks, but right now, the only thing that I should tell you is that the amplitude of these sine waves, okay, are provided by the absolute values of the thing that you get out of the FFT, and for various reasons, you always take these things squared. Okay, when you consider amplitudes of Fourier transforms, you always take the value squared. Why squared? For all kind of unimportant reasons. Okay, so what do I do here? Data, this array has a lot of trials of, again, from the, it's the same one that we used before. So it's a lot of 500 trials recorded from RET auditory cortex. Here you have all of them superimposed on each other. These hairy stuff are the spikes. Okay, they occur at different times in different different trials, and I take each one of them. I produce its Fourier transform, so I get the amplitude of these sine waves, absolute value squared, and I take the mean. Okay, so I sum them into AFS and divide by 500, because I had 500 trials. Okay, and then I draw the result. Okay, x-axis is the average amplitude, y-axis is frequency in hertz. How do I know the frequency in hertz? This has to do with I'm transforming here things. Okay, the number of frequencies that I'm going to get is the number of points that I have in the thing that I transform, and the highest frequency is always the sampling frequency. Okay, so I just this thing normalizes everything. So that lowest frequency is zero. Excuse me, lowest frequency is zero, and the highest frequency is just one below the sampling frequency. Okay, so this formula generates the right frequency. Okay, and what do I see? Y-axis is the average amplitude of each one of the frequencies. Okay, and the frequency on the x-axis are in hertz. Remember, sampling frequency is 24 kilohertz. So the x-axis, this is 5 kilohertz and so on, that's 24 kilohertz. Okay, what do you see? Okay, that's fine. Silence is okay. Okay, you don't see much. Okay, the reason is that power spectra usually have widely different values. Okay, so we never plot them on a linear Y scale. We always use the dB scale. Okay, that's something that has to do with plotting in general. The resolution, the real resolution that you get on this scale is about 10%. Okay, so you can see features that are about 10% as large, or 5% of the size of the Y scale. When we discussed attenuations, for example, that were filter attenuation that were on a dB scale, we had values of 1 and values of 1,000. Okay, so 1 to 1 per mil. That's already much, much larger than the 5% that you can really see on a linear scale. So if you want to plot things on the same scale, things that are 1 and things that are 0.001, okay, you need to go to something else, and that the dB scale is a kind of a solution. So I'm going to plot now the same thing, exactly the same thing, but I'm going to do it in dB scale. Okay, another small complication. Okay, note there's a 10 here and not a 20. Okay, why 10 and not 20? Because I had the square here. Okay, so DB scale, if the thing here has square, this is 10. If the thing here doesn't have a square, this is 20. Okay, you will have to learn it on a case by case basis. Okay, but for power spectra, it's okay. So I try to see things. I start to see things. What's the most striking feature of this figure? It's symmetric. Yeah? You can see that it's symmetric around the middle? Okay, that's a property of the Fourier transform. It's related, sort of related to the sampling frequency. Okay, to the sampling theorem. Remember, only frequencies below half the sampling rate are really there. I did a Fourier transform and I got frequencies all the way to the sampling frequency. So everything that's above the half the sampling frequency, okay, reflect in some way something that's below the half the sampling frequency, and the way that it does it is simply by getting, okay, by this type of symmetry. Again, we'll get into the more exact details in 2 weeks, but this means that I don't need all these values. It's enough for me to look at everything up to the middle. Okay, so the final plot of the power spectra is this. Okay, I go from zero to half the sampling frequency. Okay, I use a dB scale. The meaning of a dB scale, I mean, the meaning of these absolute numbers, 120 relative to 90, depends on the units that I'm using. Okay, so for us, on a dB scale, it's much more important to consider the differences, okay, which are differences of order of magnitude, than the absolute numbers. Sometimes the absolute numbers are important, and then, yeah.
Can we just use any log scale, these kind of
You could make log 10, but it's worthwhile getting used to the 10 log 10. The log 10 is a unit called bel, okay? And so 10 log 10 is 1/10 of a bel or a decibel, okay? That's where the name comes from, okay? And since the 10 log 10 is much more useful than the log 10 itself, okay, people use it so extensively that they call it dB. Why bel, by the way? Yeah, the guy who invented the phone, so. Okay, so these were technicalities. Now, what do we really see here? Okay, I just wrote here a short way of doing it. Okay, so if you provide FFT with a matrix, it will operate on the columns. Data is organized so that trials are in the columns. Okay, so it has a lot of rows, 12,000 something rows and 500 columns. So FFT will make the operation on each one of the columns separately. So it does this, but in one go. Okay, and then here I take absolute value squared, and this is mean over columns. Okay, that's the two means, that the mean is over column, and then, I cut everything in half and plot it. Okay, so I get exactly the same thing. Now here's the crucial statement, okay? Power spectra should reflect fluctuation rates that in the signal. Okay, before we went and magnified and decreased and went in and out, zoomed in and zoomed out in order to see fluctuation rates, Okay, and the power spectra in some way should be a summary of what we did by hand, okay, when we went in and out of the signal. So every feature of the power spectrum should correspond to something that we saw before in the power spectrum, in the time domain signal when we looked at it. For me, this correspondence, figuring it out, understanding it, and being able to find these corresponding features is one of the crucial expertise that someone who deals with signals should have. Okay? Power, I mean, things in the frequency domain, things in the time domain are not separate, okay? They come together. They are two expressions of the same thing. So this type of correspondence, you must be able to do it, okay? If you see a power spectrum, you should be able to find the time domain stuff that corresponds to it. If you see something in the time domain, you should be able to imagine how the power spectrum would look like. So let's take this... let's take this let's take the power spectrum and try to see what we can how we can figure out different features. So what are the most visible features here? Low frequencies. Okay? So we know, we actually know what happens at the low frequencies. Okay, this is what we did before. Why do we have such large contribution of low frequencies? Okay? Because we have very slow fluctuation rates here that are extremely large. Okay? So these things, the local field potentials, are the things that are expressed again. We figured out that these very large things have frequency content of order 30 Hz, so between 1 and 100, I mean 100 Hz, maybe a bit higher. So let's go back to look at the power spectrum, and we see that indeed, okay, the things go up to 100 Hz, maybe 200 Hz. Okay, so this thing, this very large peak at the low frequencies, reflects the LFP. That's the LFP. And this is why I could cut it at 100 Hz or 200 Hz and get rid of the LFP. So instead of looking by hand and measuring the width of the peaks, what I'm doing in real life is calculating the power spectrum and looking at where this large peak ends. Okay, and that would provide me with a good starting guess for what the frequency, which frequency I should use in order to get rid of the LFP when I want to analyze the spikes. Okay, so just by looking at this peak and finding where it ends, I get where is its bottom, okay? I get a good guess about what the cutoff frequency of a high-pass filter for removing LFP should be.
So don't you want the small peak there, or it might be something else?
Which one? That? This is probably 150, this is 150 Hz, I didn't measure it, but it's probably 50 Hz that did not get filtered out. Okay, that's a distorted 50 Hz signal, so it has harmonics, and presumably the notch filter removed the first and second harmonics, but not the third one, so we have this 50 Hz. What? The notch filter removed first and second harmonics, and the third harmonics remained, or alternatively, whatever nonlinear distortion was there created only odd harmonics. That might be also happening. So the 50 Hz got removed, but the 150 Hz. You see, the third peak is at 300 Hz. Okay, so it's a harmonic of that. Okay, if they are very narrow, usually they would not be biology. Okay, we'll talk in a moment about this peak. Okay, this peak turns out to be important. Okay, but okay, so that's the low frequency peak. What's the next most obvious feature of the... What? Yeah, but okay. For me, the next most annoying feature here is this. okay? Huge content of frequency near the half the sampling frequency. As I told you, that's bad, okay? This is usually, that's usually a sign of something bad in the hardware, in the sampler. Okay, you shouldn't have a frequency content close to half the sampling rate. As I told you, there should be a low-pass filter there. Okay, the low-pass filter should make sure that you are in the pass band at 12 kilohertz, so the corner frequency should be at about here. Okay, and so in principle, you should be here at the noise flow of whatever you're calculating. The fact that you have this sudden increase close to half the sampling rate means that something bad is happening at the sampler. You will often have it. Okay, I showed you two pieces of data coming from two different labs, two different data acquisition systems, both of which have this type of high frequency stuff. Okay, so let's try to look for it. Okay, so something that happens close to the half the sampling rate should have this shape where you have one sample going down, the next one going up, the next one going down, the next one going up, and so on. So you have here a burst of something that is close to half the sampling frequency. Okay, for some reason these bursts, these high frequency things occur in bouts. Okay, so you have here a period of like that, and before and after there was less of it, and then you have another one here, okay, and here's another one, okay, so here's another one, okay, so these are the things that contribute to the peak near the near half the sampling frequency. Okay, again, a feature in the frequency domain should by necessity come with something in the time domain that corresponds to it. Actually, the correspondences should be even a bit closer, because the width of this peak here, okay, should correspond to the duration of these things. Okay, that's the duration here is a few milliseconds, so a few milliseconds, maybe less than a few milliseconds. Yeah, a few milliseconds. So the width here should be order of 1 kilohertz. A few hundred, yeah, that's about it. Okay, now we have also these peaks in the middle. I'm not going to look for them, they would be noise too. Okay, what I want to see, to look at now, is these things. The reason I'm not going to look for them is because I know they are noise. They are very narrow. Okay, I don't know exactly where they come from. They may be all kind of computer stuff that interfere with the signals from the electrode. I don't know. Okay, but for sure they are not biology, because they are so narrow and. What does interest me?
Action potentials, maybe.
Exactly. No, not narrow. Narrow means very, very, very sine wave like. In order to be, again, remember this type of uncertainty principle. If the line is very narrow, okay, the thing that created it is very long. Okay, so spike is very short. So it won't create narrow stuff, it will create broadband stuff. Okay, the feature that really interests me are these periodic peaks. Okay, you see that there is a kind of a periodic structure here with things that are much, much wider than these lines that are presumably interference of some kind or another. Okay, so okay, let's look at the frequencies. What are the frequencies of these peaks? So this is about 400 hertz. Okay, This is about 800 Hertz. Okay, this is maybe a little bit more than 1.2 kilohertz. That would be, so they come in jumps of about 400 Hertz, maybe a bit more. Okay, so if you have a peaks that comes in fixed jumps or approximately fixed jumps, what would they reflect? Periodic peaks in the frequency domain reflect periodic stuff in the time domain. Okay, so what periodic stuff in the time domain do we have in these at about 400 Hertz do we have in these traces? The burst of the spike that I showed you before. Okay, so this periodic structure at about 400 Hertz corresponds to the burst, to this very intense burst of spikes that come from the this big spike that's on the electrode. Okay, so the goal of this exercise again is to show you to emphasize the relationships that there is between time domain and frequency domain structure. Okay, everything that I see in the frequency domain comes from stuff I can identify in the time domain. Okay, the advantage of the frequency domain representation is that I have it all in one go. Okay, I don't need to go and look for these things. So I can read this structure, for example. I can see, okay, that if I filter at 2 kHz like I did before, I am going to get rid of, for example, this peak that according to my interpretation is part of the belong to the spikes. Okay, so I'm going to hit the spikes. Okay, so if I want to do my low pass, okay, the high frequency part of the band pass, okay, should be at frequency that above that. Okay, so that I don't hit these peaks that come from the periodic structure of the bursting and belong to the spikes. I want to jump. Okay, so for the data that I showed you until now, they were cut in trials, so I used the trials as the basic unit for doing the Fourier transform and for interpreting the resulting shapes. I want to go into one technicality here. Okay, and the technicality has to do with the use of windows. Okay. So these are two trials from the trials that from this block, this data block. Okay, and the reason that I selected the blue one is because it shows an artifactual discontinuity. There's a discontinuity in this trial. Can you see it? A large discontinuity. From where to where? Okay, the discontinuity is from here to here. Okay, when you do Fourier transforms, okay, the mass actually lives on a circle. And so as far as the Fourier transform is concerned, that point is neighbor of that point. Okay, it goes on a circle. Now, if you have a discontinuity in your time function, this very fast continuity in the time function, the Fourier transform will need a lot of high frequencies. Okay, will produce a lot of high frequencies that are really there in order to create this specific shape, but in a way are artifactual. They are not part, really part of the signal. So the standard way of getting rid of the of these discontinuities is, before doing the Fourier transform, make sure that the two edges of the signal are at the same height. And the way that you do it is by multiply by a bell shape that's zero here, zero here, and it has some maximum in the middle. So it would go like that. Okay? And that makes sure that the edges are continuous. Okay, so here's a window like that. Okay, this is actually one of the it looks like a Gaussian. There's a huge amount of lore about the right windows to use. Okay, this is theoretically one of the better windows out there. Okay, it's called a DPSS window. DPSS is a discrete polarized spheroidal frequencies. Doesn't matter. Okay, there's an interesting, elegant theory that's completely unimportant at the moment, but all shapes will roughly look like that. Okay, they will be close to zero at the edges, they will be very rounded. Okay, and by convention, they are normalized so that their peak is at 1. Okay, so when you calculate the power spectrum, you always have to supply the window. I have here the code in order to do that, but I don't want... Okay. It doesn't make a big difference for the for these segments. Okay, they look, since the segments I was using for the power spectrum are so long, they look pretty much the same, so I'm not going to emphasize that. The place where the okay, where this becomes important is if you don't have the data cut into trials, but you have one long continuous signal. Okay, so the MATLAB function, that's the last thing I want to discuss, the MATLAB function that calculates a power spectra, or the one that I prefer to use, is called P-Welch. I think I put here the definitions. Okay, P. Welch. So P is for power spectrum and Welch is for the guy who invented the procedure. It's really a very simple procedure. You take your signal, you cut it into segments, okay? You overlap them by one half, okay, that's the default. For each one of these segments, you do what we did. FFT, I mean, multiply by window, FFT, absolute value squared average. Instead of doing it by hand, P. Welch does it for you. So these are the arguments. VEC is the long signal that you from which you want to calculate the power spectrum. N is the length of each one of the individual segments you are going to take into the Fourier transform. And the trade-off here is that the longer it is, the more frequencies are estimated, but less well. Okay, so for statistical stability, you want to have short n, so you will have a lot of segments in the, and you will average a lot. To have a high frequency resolution, you want to have a long n. Okay, so the longer your n, the better the frequency resolution, but the statistics are less good. The estimates are more variable. The next two parameters, you should take always the defaults, and then the sampling rate, so that when P. Welch draws the power spectrum, it will know how to label the x-axis. Okay, if you want to provide P. Welch with a specific window, you put the window here as a second argument. Otherwise, it has its own default. It has a default that it uses. It's not a bad one. It's not the best one either. Okay, so what I'm in 2 minutes, what I'm going to do now is to take the up and down states that we used yesterday. Okay, remember, we found the relevant part of the frequency content. We found it by hand. Okay, and then we used filters, rough filters, in order to separate them. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is to take this exactly the same two segments that we had yesterday. Oh, that's not what I wanted. This is what I wanted. Okay, so this is copied from the presentation. Okay, I take exactly the same two figures, the two segments we worked with. Okay, that's a plot that we had yesterday. And now I'm calculating, I'm using P. Welch to calculate the two power spectra for the up state and for the down state. Okay, and here are the power spectra of the up states and down states. Okay, if you remember, so down state is blue, and up state is in red, and you can see the separation of the two lines. The higher power, so the more fluctuation that the up state has in this range of frequencies, that go from about 50 hertz, okay, we use 20 hertz, 50 milliseconds, okay, all the way to about 1 kilohertz, okay, which is, we used about higher, something here. Okay, so you can see that by eye, what we did by eye, okay, is reflected fully in the power spectra. We see very nicely the separation of the fluctuation rates in the up and down states. So again, the power spectrum serves here as a kind of a summary. Okay, we see all the fluctuation rates that we looked for by hand. We see them reflected here, and this fluctuation range, the range of fluctuation rate at which the up state was thicker than the down state, is reflected very nicely in the power spectrum. Okay, so tomorrow you have this file week1.doc. Okay, it has the exercises, the data files are on the Moodle page, and we'll sit here the first 2 hours or so. We'll sit here, you will be running the exercises, and Matan and me will, you know Matan? Here's Matan. Okay. Matan and me will go around helping you. Those who are more experienced will be able to do more of the exercises, and can go beyond what's suggested in the file. Those who are less experienced in MATLAB will probably not finish everything. But you should at least try to do as much as possible. Essentially, all the code that's necessary in order to implement the exercises is in the script. Okay, you don't need to invent things. You have to, you can use the scripts from the lessons, okay, in order to pick up the small bits that are necessary in order to do things, but you need to understand what you're doing. In the last hour, we will reconvene, and I will do by hand the exercise. Okay, I will generate an M file, okay, that does it, okay, and which you will get at the end as a kind of school answers. Okay, so see you tomorrow. זה הפרמטר, כן, שני הפרמטרים ששמתי שם כסוגריים מרובעים, השני זה ה-overlap, והשלישי זה האור של ה-FFT, זה כמה זירו פדינג את רוצה לעשות. בסדר, את יכולה, כמה זירו, מה אורך ה-FFT? את יכולה להגיד לו, תיקח...
go ahead.